Good afternoon, church family. Welcome to this Wednesday edition of Staying Connected. I'm Jeremy Cole, the youth pastor here at St. Mary's United Methodist Church. As always, it is a joy and honor to greet you with God's word and prayer. Today, we're continuing right along in our series, Red Letters, where we're looking through the Gospel of John at the different parts when Jesus spoke. If you have a red letter Bible, you'll see that the red letters in the New Testament are Jesus' words. So we're just going to continue on. We are in chapter 4 today. Starting at verse 4, we're going to go to verse 26. Now he had gone through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy some food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him if he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this well will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming that has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I am the one speaking to you. I am he." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So there's a few things to break all that down that I want to go through with you guys. So Jesus does something here before he even speaks to the woman at the well. He does something that went very much against the cultural grain of that time. He was a Jew passing through Samaria. Jews didn't just pass through Samaria. Jews, in fact, typically would go out of their way to avoid Samaria as much as they could. The straight line of travel from where Jesus was traveling to Jerusalem would have taken him right through Samaria. But instead, what most rabbis and most Jewish people would have done at the time would have been to go several miles out of the way to kind of curve around and avoid that main road that came through Samaria, because there's just seriously just some racial hate there that went back for years and years and years and years, generations and generations, that they purposely did not associate with each other if they could avoid it, even so much as adding a half day travel to their trip if they had to. So Jesus does something bold initially before he even meets the woman at the well by passing through Samaria. Most people wouldn't have done that. So then when he's passing through Samaria, it's in the middle of the afternoon, and he's at the well where the well that Jacob had put, and he's sitting there and he asks this Samaritan woman. Not only does he ask a Samaritan, but he asks a woman for a drink. And she's just blown away by this, because she is just shocked that a Jewish man is even in her town, and that he's asking her for something, asking her for some hospitality, which just, this was totally foreign. It didn't happen. And she's just kind of in a little bit of shock by it. So Jesus asks her for a drink, and then she basically says, well, you don't have anything to draw from the well with. And then he offers her something else. He says, if you would have known who I was, you would have asked me for living water. And then they get into a conversation about what living water is and about how it brings eternal life. And what he's talking about is the living water of having Christ in her life, trusting in Christ and trusting in him as her savior, because he was the Christ who she knew was coming, but she didn't know that's who she was talking to until the end of the conversation. Another thing Jesus does is he knows all about her before he even meets her. He knows that she's led a life of adultery. He knows that she's had multiple men in her life, and he doesn't open with that. He opens with just asking her for some hospitality and meeting her where she was, an outcast in her community, at the well in the afternoon. Most women, when they go to draw water from the well, or Samaritan people or any kind of person in this time, when they would go to draw water from the well, they would do it in the cool of the day, in the morning time. And she's here in the afternoon because no one else is there in the afternoon. She can't get ridiculed. She's welcome at the well in the afternoon because no one else is there to turn her away and to make her feel outcast. So the afternoon is her time to be at the well. And there she is with Jesus, and she's just shocked that really anyone's at the well at this time, and that it's a Jewish man. So he meets her where she is, and then he starts telling her about her life, and really not in a harsh, judgmental way, but in a graceful, convicting kind of way. And he reveals to her all the things he knows about her, and by the end of the conversation, she puts her trust in Jesus. And then a few short verses after this, she goes back into town, tells all the townspeople that she has met the Messiah, and brings them out to meet him. So Jesus transforms this lady's life. And he does it by just meeting her where she is, offering her grace and convicting her of her sins, and just totally changing who she was, so much that she was bold enough to go tell the people in the town that she was an outcast of, that she had met the Messiah. And what an amazing, just real quick transformation of someone's life, where Jesus comes into their life and really starts to turn it around just in a short amount of time. So that gets me thinking about where we are. Where are we in something that we should be convicted of? What's something on our hearts that Jesus is convicting us and trying to offer us grace for? Could be something that no one else knows, and that something that maybe you've just kept secret, and it's something that you really need to turn from. And Jesus is offering you grace for that. Just as he offered the woman at the well, that he's offering all of us that same transforming grace. And when we accept it, it will truly change our lives. We will be not who we used to be before. Like 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, the old will be gone, and behold, the new will come. That when we accept that transforming, amazing grace to convict whatever sin is in our lives and make us brand new, make us new people, after Jesus' heart, and not giving in to those same temptations that we've always done, truly repented and new creations. So I challenge you guys, whatever that is, offer Jesus to come in and take it from you and receive his grace. Because if he can do it for an outcasted Samaritan woman that truly didn't even expect to see her and see him in her town, then imagine what he could do for us here in South Georgia, where there's nearly a church on every corner. Let's pray. God, thank you for your love. Thank you for this amazing word that not only did it transform the Samaritan woman, but it can enter our hearts and transform us too. We ask you, God, just to meet us where we are, grab a hold of, of us by conviction, and pour out your grace in us so that we know that we can run towards you and turn away from the temptations that we have in our lives. In your son's name, amen.